All right, we are starting this morning on a new study. We are starting into the book of Romans. Okay, and I think for many of us, this is going to be a life-changing adventure. It might be a life-changing adventure just because, just like all the other books in Scripture, they are written by God to us through human beings, right? And every time we study Scripture, I think we're learning more and more about God and giving Him honor. So that's what we're doing a lot of that now. And as we delve into this Scripture and into the study of Romans, I believe that we need to seek the illumination of God's Spirit. As we study, we need to make ourselves humble before God, and we need to allow Him to open up our hearts to understand what He's trying to teach us. Just like David said in the 119th Psalm, he said, "Open my eyes that I may behold wonderful things from your law." So we must ask God to humbly teach us His truth. We must also look to the attitude that James had in James 1, where he says, he tells us to humbly receive God's word implanted, which is able to save our souls. And truly it is. We must put away all sin and allow God to direct us in the study of His Word. This is also one of the things you have to realize. This is only 16 chapters, but this is going to be a long study. So, as you know, but it will be a long study. It will take us a lot of work. It'll take a lot of work on my part, but I think it'll take a lot of work on your part as we study and as we look into the book of Romans, because you need to read it and study along so you can understand it from your standpoint, reading Scripture. Because we live in a very different culture than the first century Christians, don't we? I mean, we're separated historically by 2,000 years. But we want to understand God's Word. We are in a society where we wanted things to be done quickly. I don't believe in that when we study Scripture. I think it takes time to really understand what God's trying to tell us. Well, this letter, Romans, this book, Romans, has probably played a more significant role down through the history than any other book of Scripture. You heard Sean talking about it today. And it's amazing when you go back in history to just see how much this book has affected people's lives. So I want to look this morning at some of the things that have been achieved through the history of the church through the book of Romans. So we'll start. The year is 386, the latter part of the 4th century. There's a young man whose father was a pagan and his mother was a devout Christian. This young man had devoted his life, the whole of his life, to immorality. He's already fathered an illegitimate son. Yet his mother is continuing to pray for his soul. And one day this young man finds himself in a garden where a copy of the New Testament was sitting on a lectern there in the garden. And as he paced in the garden, just whatever he was thinking about, we don't really know, he heard children singing the refrain to a childhood song from a game, saying, "Tole lege, tole lege," which means take up and read, take up and read. And as he heard those children singing that, he was moved to go look at the Scriptures. He said, "I'm hearing this. I'm going to go look at that Scripture since it's right here." And as he opened the scroll, by the providence of God, it fell open to what we now have numbered as Romans 13, verses 13 and 14. But then it was just in a scroll. So who's got Romans 13, 13 and 14? I think you got that, don't you?
"Let us behave properly as in the day, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual promiscuity and sensuality, not in strife and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in regard to its lusts."
Yeah, this young man had devoted his life to immorality, okay? And he picks up Scripture. He's hearing these kids sing, let us read, okay? And he picks up and what does he say? "Let us behave properly in the day, not drunkenness and carousing, not in sexual immorality or promiscuity, not in strife and jealousy, but what? Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh and its lust." And that's all he had been doing through his life. So as Aurelius Augustine read these words, the Spirit of God took them and pierced him between the joint and marrow, between the bone and marrow, and the very depths, to the very depths of his soul. By the power of God's Spirit, Augustine was converted to the Christian faith. And we know him today as St. Augustine of Hippo. From those few words, from that one sentence in Romans, the church received the great Augustine, probably one of the most exalted, and he had more influence on the church than almost any other theologian. Now that was back in 386, and it was Augustine who refuted and demolished the teachings of Pelagius, I think is his name, a British theologian known for promoting doctrines that emphasized human choice and salvation. He denied original sin, and he taught that man could save himself. And there was a big argument in the church in those days about that: can man save himself, or is it God? Well, Augustine refuted these teachings using the book of Romans. And so we see what a great influence Romans had on Augustine, both at bringing him to Christ, and he used it in battling heresy in the church. Then a second one, and a second example would be from in November of 1515, we see a young Augustinian monk who had diligently pursued his doctoral studies in the work of St. Augustine, and he was consigned to a university as a professor of sacred theology at the Catholic University of Wittenberg. He began to expound on the Epistle of Romans to his students. And from November of 1515 until September of 1516, he daily studied the Epistle of Romans to help him understand what it said. And as he worked daily, he became more and more appreciative of the doctrine of justification by faith. So as Martin Luther continued to prepare his lectures on Romans and studying the epistle's first chapter, he found a notation in an ancient manuscript that was handwritten by Augustine himself, and it defined the righteousness of Christ. What Augustine wrote was that when Paul speaks of the righteousness of God here in Romans 1, it is not the righteousness by which God himself is righteous, but the righteousness that he freely gives to those who put their trust in Christ. And for the first time in his life, Martin Luther, whose conscience had been wounded by the burden of the law that exposed his relentless guilt, from that moment, Martin Luther understood the gospel of Christ. Paul's teaching on the doctrine of justification by faith alone gave Luther the strength to stand against the Roman Catholic Church in the 16th century, which began the Protestant Reformation. All because he discovered the truth of the gospel in the book of Romans. All right, that's two examples. The third example I have happened in May of 1738. A man who was already ordained in the ministry of the Anglican Church of England was listening to a message being delivered outside in London at Aldersgate. John Wesley went to this Moravian meeting unwillingly. He didn't want to go, but he went. And it was there that when he was listening to Martin Luther's preface to the Epistle of Romans being read, that he says he felt his heart strangely warmed. And you know, at Aldersgate, that's when he accepted Christ. And it was then that he trusted Christ and Christ alone for his salvation. He had an assurance that God had taken away his sin and saved him. And so it was on Aldersgate Street at the reading of Romans that John Wesley was redeemed. That critical moment in John Wesley's life provided the spark that kindled the blaze of the 18th century evangelical revival. Without it, Aldersgate was a pivotal moment in church history. Without it, Wesley and Methodism may never have been what we would have never known it as it is. And that all happened because of Romans. A fourth example, one of the most eloquent preachers of the church has ever known is John Chrysostom of Constantinople. And he always said that the Epistle of Romans was so remarkable that he needed to read it twice weekly. And John Calvin said of Romans, if a man understands it, he has a sure road open to him to understand the whole of Scripture. So you see with these great theologians, I mean, you've got Augustine, you've got John Wesley, you've got Calvin, you've got Martin Luther, and all these men have been affected, their lives have been affected by the book of Romans. Why is Paul's message, his epistle of Romans, why does it have such an effect down the ages on men and women? Well, one thought is that Romans is fundamentally a book about God. Paul talks a lot about God. He talks about the gospel and about salvation, but he talks a lot about God in the book of Romans. The word God is used 153 times in the book of Romans. It's actually, apart from prepositions and pronouns, no word is used more in the book of Romans than God. Law is used 72 times. Christ is used 65 times. Sin, 48 times. Lord, 48 times. Faith, 40 times. But God, 153 times. Paul does write on a number of topics, but everything is related to God. And this is probably what gives Romans its importance. All right, so let me ask you, who wrote the letter? Yeah, Paul. I mean, let's look. Let's read Romans 1:1. It's pretty obvious who wrote it.
Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, called as an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God.
Yeah, and we already knew that Paul had wrote it. How did we as a class know that Paul had already written it? What did we just study?
Acts.
And in Acts, did he not stop somewhere for a while? And during that time in Greece, wrote? He was in Corinth. And he wrote, yeah. He stopped. He left during his second. I think we saw in Acts. We saw Paul leave Ephesus on his third missionary journey, and he went down through Macedonia and then down into Greece. Remember, then he went down into Corinth, and it was during the winter of 54 and 55 that he stayed in Greece and wrote the book of the letter to the Romans in Corinth. And we know that he stayed with Gaius. He stayed in the house of Gaius there. And I think it's very interesting. And we're going to go to the end of Romans, in Romans 16, and read Romans 16, verse 23.
Gaius, host me, and to the whole church greets you. Erastus, the city treasurer, greets you, and Quartus, the brother.
Yeah, so he stayed with Gaius while he was there for that 3 months. But who is Gaius? Well, we know that Paul came on his second missionary journey to Corinth, and it was there that he baptized someone. Let's read that, 1 Corinthians 1, verses 14 and 15.
I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, that no man should say you were baptized in my name.
Yeah, see, so all this falls in well. He baptized a man named Gaius on his second missionary journey, and then on his third missionary journey, he comes back to Corinth, and he stays there with Gaius. Okay, so that's kind of how that comes together. And then, but he also had a secretary there who was writing this for him, and his name was Tertius. Let's read that in Romans 16, verse 22.
I, Tertius, who write this letter, greet you in the Lord.
Yeah, I think that's really interesting. Paul's not saying this, is he? He says, I, Tertius, who write this letter, greet you in the Lord. He must have gotten permission or something from Paul to send his greetings, or maybe because he didn't. This is not the end of it. It's only 16:22. There's more verses past that. So Paul must have given him permission to identify himself as the one who wrote the letter. And you know, in most cases, Paul didn't write his own letters. He had someone writing there with him. It's thought that Paul very possibly, at this late age, in his 40s and 50s, that he very possibly had cataracts. And nothing could really be done with cataracts in those days like they can today. So let's look what he said to the people in Galatians, when he wrote Galatians 6, verse 11. Who's got that?
I do. See with what large letters I have written to you with my own hand.
Yeah, I mean, why would he say, see what large letters I have written to you? I mean, he obviously knows how to write Greek, right? So the only thing, there are people that think that he probably had vision problems, and that's why he was writing large letters, because he wasn't able to see them, okay? Those of us that have cataracts can really relate to that. So, but we don't know. He might just have been had trouble writing. We don't know, but he usually had an unamanuensis, which is a person who was employed to write from dictation. So, but we know that he himself wrote this letter to Galatians, but most of the letters he had someone who wrote for him, like Tertius. Well, this letter, Romans, it was from Paul, had to get somehow from Corinth to Rome, didn't it? So we want to look and see who possibly took it. So let's read Romans 16, verses 1 and 2.
I commend to you our sister Phoebe, who is a servant of the church, which is at Cenchrea, that you receive her in the Lord in a manner worthy of the saints, and that you help her in whatever matters she may have need of you. For she herself has also been a helper of many, and of myself as well.
Yeah, Paul's brief commendation of Phoebe, but yes, it's commendation, not condemnation, yeah, has received a great amount of attention amongst people even today, trying to understand the role of women in the life of the early church. Phoebe is identified as our sister in faith and a servant of the church. Now, servant is the Greek word diakonos, and we know what we get from diakonos. We get deacon, right? It's either deacon or deaconess, and since it's speaking about a woman, so this is deaconess or a servant at the church. Here we see Phoebe called a female deacon or a servant at the church. Well, whether or not Phoebe was actually a deaconess of the church, it's not clear. But she seems to be a trusted member of the body of believers at Cenchrea. And Cenchrea was the port of Corinth. It's about 8 miles from Corinth, but it was their seaport. So Paul directs the believers in Rome to receive her in the Lord in a manner worthy of the saints. He's asking them to treat her as they would treat him. She is to be assisted in whatever she needs because she is a helper of many, it says. Yeah.
According to my notes in the Bible, it said Phoebe may have been the carrier.
Yeah, that's where I'm headed with this. They think she was probably the bearer of the letter. Yeah. And they might have given it to a woman to keep it safe too. You don't know. So yeah. But that's the thing. We don't know. It never says in Scripture who carried it, but there's so much this great commendation of Phoebe. You know, there's little doubt that she must have been either the bearer, as you say, of the letter, or she was just there with them carrying the letter from Corinth up to Rome, okay? Because she was such a servant at the church at Cenchrea. So yeah, I'm with the people who believe she probably carried it. But there's nothing in Scripture that tells us that. But when he talks about this woman so much, I pretty much think she probably was the carrier of the letter. Okay, so on to next. To whom was the letter written? Well, we don't know very much about the early church in Rome. We really don't. You know, it's possible that the Jews who were from Rome, who were in Jerusalem on that day of Pentecost when the Holy Spirit came alive in the Jewish believers, possibly they might have something to do with it. Let's go back to Acts 2 and read Acts 2, verse 10, which is going to tell us about all those people. I'm not doing all the verses of everybody who was there, but this is where they mention the ones from Rome.
Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the districts of Libya around Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes.
So you see there are people from Rome there, both Jews and proselytes, and people were from all over the known world. And that's what all those other verses that we didn't read. So all these people that were there, and they even include Asia. Asia's pretty big. So, but they include all those. It's possible that those visitors from Rome, those Jewish believers who trusted in the Lord and were filled with the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, went back to Rome and began that church. But we really don't have, there's no record that I've been able to find that tells us much about that. But by the time Paul wrote Romans, it was already a well-known church throughout the world. Let's look at that in Romans 1, verse 8.
First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, because your faith is being proclaimed throughout the whole world.
See, he's writing this to him, and it's all, and that church has been going for a while, and he says your faith has been going for, your faith is proclaimed throughout the whole world. It's likely that those Jewish Christians returned to Rome after Pentecost and established the church. So the church then was has likely existed since the mid-30s, all right? And now we're talking about 20 to 25 years later. So in that 20 to 25 years, the church has become well-known all over the world. So this letter is written to believers in Rome. But we don't know the Jewish-Gentile mix of the church. Paul is probably writing to a Jewish Christian church with Gentiles attending there, but there may be more Gentiles at this church than we realize. So let's look at what Paul says in his intro in Romans 1, verses 5 and 6.
Through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles for his name's sake, among whom you also are the called of Jesus Christ.
Yeah, Paul was the apostle to the Gentiles. And he specifically here includes his Roman readers, both Jew and Gentile, within the sphere of his Gentile commission. This implies the majority of his readers very well might have been Gentiles. So we actually see this strengthened a little bit later in his letter in Romans 11, verse 13. Who's got that?
But I'm speaking to you who are Gentiles. Inasmuch then as I am an apostle of Gentiles, I magnify my ministry.
Yeah, we see again that Paul is writing to Gentiles, but he doesn't exclude the Jews. I don't think he excludes the Jewish Gentiles, or Jewish Christians. He addresses them all throughout the letter. But it's my opinion that he is writing to both Jew and Gentile. But there's a lot of Gentiles that are going to be in there, that are going to be there. All right, so why? Let's ask the question now, why did Paul write his letter? Well, one reason is that he wanted to evangelize the West. See, he's moving on in his ministry, and he's evangelizing West. And we want to look at what he said in Romans 18, verse 28. Excuse me.
15:28.
Yeah. I'm sorry.
Therefore, when I finish this and have put my seal on this fruit of theirs, I will go on by way of you to Spain.
Yeah, Paul wanted to use Rome as a new base of operations from which the gospel could move west. Okay, he's trying to get it on into Spain and into the Western Mediterranean world from Rome. But he can't really keep Antioch as his base. He's got to move, and his new base is going to be Rome. He didn't want to go where the gospel had been preached. He wanted to go where no Christian had walked before. All right, so let's read Romans 15, verse 19 and 20.
So that from Jerusalem and round about as far as Illyricum, I have fully preached the gospel of Christ, and thus I aspire to preach the gospel, not where Christ was already named, so that I would not build on another man's foundation.
Yeah, Paul says that he has fully preached the gospel of Christ from Jerusalem all up to Illyricum. And now Illyricum was a Roman province. Let me show you. If you look here, you can see that is that upside down? That is upside down. It's a Roman province on the eastern side of the Adriatic Sea. Okay, it's all that land on the east of the Adriatic Sea. But he says he has taken the gospel from Jerusalem all the way up to, I think it's called Illyricum, yeah. And if you notice that here, you have on your former map that we've had following Paul, that means he's gone from Jerusalem here all the way up through here. Oh, he's taken it all through this part of the world. He's gone up through Macedonia, and he's gone all down into Greece. So, and everything from here on up is Illyricum. So that's what he's saying. I've gone all the way from Jerusalem to Illyricum. And he's saying that he's covered that territory well with the gospel. So now he wants to move to his new base, and that would be Rome. His eastern base, of course, as I said, was Antioch. And now he wants to get to a place, he wants to go to a place where people don't know the name of Jesus. He didn't want to build on another man's work. He wanted to build new work for Jesus. So we see here, Paul is writing mostly to Gentiles, but it's interesting. Early on in his letter, he actually makes his missionary method known. So let's look at Romans 1, verse 16. You know this verse well, I'm sure.
For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek.
And see, he's telling them, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It's the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, not just Jews, but to go goes to the Jews first and then to the Greek. So he's telling these Roman Christians that his method of evangelism is to go to the Jew first and then on to the Gentiles. But not only was he speaking to the Jews first, he was telling these Gentile world that the message was, that his message was essentially Jewish, but it's meant for all. So how would these Gentiles respond? Well, if you remember from our study in Acts, the Roman Emperor Claudius expelled all the Jews from Rome in the year 49. The Jews and the Jewish Christians were in constant conflict. And because of all these disturbances that were going on in Rome, Emperor Claudius banished all Jews from Rome in the year 49. Well, if you remember, Priscilla and Aquila were some of those Jews who had been banished from Rome, and they met Paul, if you remember that. And my notes went to, here we go. Here we go. They were banished from Rome. And this dismissal, though, of the Jews had a significant effect on the Roman churches. I mean, the Jewish proselytes were the only one who could now worship in the synagogues. They weren't Jews, they were Gentiles who had become Jewish. But they weren't the ones who were banished, only the Jews had been banished. So they were the ones in the synagogues, and all the Jewish believers had to leave. So all the Christians, Jewish Christians had to leave as well. Now they had their Gentile house churches which developed over a number of years, totally apart from any Jewish influence. So when Nero became emperor in the year 54, when he became emperor, many Jews started to return back to Rome, along with the Jewish Christians. And when we think about this, Paul probably wrote this letter probably in the year 54 to 55, and it may have been a little bit after that. It may have been 56, 57. We don't have exact dates on when he wrote it, but they said it had to have been written before 58. And if you think about that, that's when the Jews had just returned, because Nero had just become emperor. And if he wrote it in 54, 55, Nero had just taken over, and the Jews were just now starting to return. So there were probably tensions with these Jews coming back with the Gentiles in their churches, or they might have been blessed to have the Jews back. We don't know. But Paul needs for these Christians, both Jews and Gentiles, to understand that the gospel that he is preaching is in line with all that God told Israel. It's for the Jews first, but it's also for the Greeks. It's also for the Gentiles. The gospel makes everyone, one in Christ. And he told the Galatians that when he wrote that book that he wrote. Let's read Galatians 3, verse 28.
There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free man, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus.
Yeah, neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, everyone is one in Christ Jesus. So Paul goes strong in theology in the book of Romans, because he wants these people there to understand the Jewishness of the gospel and not hate their Jewish brothers and sisters. Paul is going to attempt to unify the church in Rome through doctrine so that the church will be a strong base of operations for world evangelism. Paul wanted to build a strategic church in Rome to unify them so that they would function as a home base for missions to go out to the Western world. Well, one last thing we do need to remember, though, as we start our study in Romans, this book, this letter, was not written to us. This book was written to the first century Roman Christians. And this letter is certainly applicable to us today. I mean, look at how it's affected Augustine, Martin Luther, John Wesley, John Calvin, and hundreds and thousands of Christians, thousands, millions of Christians, it's affected their lives. So I think it's going to be a wonderful study as we head into it. You know, but before we apply it to our lives, I think we need to understand its meaning to the original audience. And as we do that, I think it will come alive to us as well. And next week we will start our study into Romans. Any thoughts or questions?
Yeah, I think you also have to consider this might have had an effect he didn't even expect. When he wrote this letter preparing his way to go to Rome, he didn't think he'd be arriving there as a prisoner.
No, he didn't. That's true.
But having read this letter, would that be what caused those people to want to go where he was and listen to his word since they allowed that to happen?
Yeah, that's probably so. You know, God has a better plan than we do, don't he? Even though he didn't want to be in prison, but he was just in a house prison. He was in a house arrest, wasn't he?
Right. Yeah. But if they read this, they probably wanted to go hear from him in person.
Absolutely. And they did. Remember right. When they greeted him when he came in?
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, did you? I had a hand up here.
I'm pretty sure I'm right on this when we were doing studies with Ann Hillier. I'm pretty sure she grew up in this church.
Right.
And she writes Bible studies, mm-hmm. and has videos now. She has a huge impact on people. She still lives in Oklahoma. But anyway, I'm pretty sure that in this church, when she wanted all of a sudden as a teenager to dig deeper into the gospel, she went to her room and started reading Romans.
That's it, yeah.
And she has this wonderful ministry now.
Yeah, she does. Absolutely does, yeah. I mean, your Bible study has used a lot of her stuff, haven't it? Yeah. But yeah, and this is the book, if you want doctrine, and there's going to be some different ways of looking at it, because there is one way, and we're going to go through all the different ways of looking at it as we study, because I'm not trying to change anybody's mind as I teach. I mean, I might have my way of looking at it, you might have yours, but we want to see what God tells us is his way. What I believe may not be what you do, but it's going to be an interesting study as we go through it, because it is the deepest book in Scripture, I think. One of, definitely. Anybody else? All right, let's pray.
Before we close, can I ask a question?
Sure.
Did you have time to look up about that ministry we were talking about?
Not yet. I need